certainly when I was a little boy and a teenager starting out, even in the early stages of my career when I was working, we didn't have this immediacy that puppetry has now and that puppeteers have. I'm so grateful for the immediacy of connectivity and social media and all of that right now. But I'm telling you the truth, I'm glad I didn't have it when I was starting out, because when I used to write a fan letter to a puppeteer, I would have to wait weeks or months for a reply. And so in the interim, I would make more stuff. And then I would photograph it and get those photographs developed, and then I would mail those photographs to that person. But in the interim of hearing back from them or getting an answer to a question, I would just have to keep working in silence, because I think the best thing for any creative mind or any artistic mind is to learn early and hold fast to an appreciation for working in silence by yourself. I don't think the best ideas come from all of this constant chatter, all of this constant posting of, I have an idea for this show, what do you all think? There's so much of that online right now. I cringe, actually, when people are so desperate for attention before they've even done something. So I learned early on as an odd child, and I find that most puppeteers I know, most artists that I admire, actually, were odd loner children. I've found, who learned how to spend time by themselves and make up impossible worlds. So that's changed puppetry. I think there's been, I might get in trouble for this, but I think there's less mastery of actual craft and technique these days, because people are not spending endless hours just working on a technical thing on their own and failing, because we've forgotten how to fail. But the other side of that is that a whole new generation of puppeteers have found each other. So it is more global that way. And they are connected and knowing what's going on in the whole scene. So that's pretty rich. That's pretty exciting. And that's valid, I think.
What about masters and apprentices?
Well, we've lost that, haven't we? I think. I don't know what's happening in all countries, you know, but my experience was that I would go live with or study with or work for puppeteers when I was younger with no expectation of being paid. And anybody who wants to apprentice to me now sort of asked me early on how much they'll be paid per hour. And that's just a contemporary sort of situation that you deal with. No one's offered themselves to me as a true apprentice, so I just kind of roll my eyes about that. I think the other another part of where contemporary puppetry is, or world puppetry is, visibly, I mean, in the press, puppetry looks awfully big right now. You know, it's huge, and it seems commercial producers are really embracing puppetry. And ever since, perhaps, I don't know, would it be Julie Taymor would be the beginning of this curve, I think, and certainly War Horse, which is everywhere and a stunning success, and Disney doing other large puppet things on stage, and now King Kong here, which is possibly the biggest, most impressive puppet ever put on stage. And I was saying to someone just today, you know, I wonder what it'd been like if 10-year-old Ronnie had sat in King Kong, and that was my first attraction to puppetry. You know, how would you go back to your parents' house and sit in your little room and dream about puppetry if it starts that big? But it certainly brought puppetry to the masses. And I think in terms of some of it, it's very successful. Some of it's not for me. Some of it is large prop puppetry. And I don't like prop puppetry, because to me, puppetry is about creating a believable character that the audience emotionally attaches to. And so some of the spectacle stuff is just a bit Hollywood for me. But, you know, that's the current face of puppetry. It's big. All I want younger puppeteers to know is to relentlessly play with and explore the craft. And play being, in the true sense of the word, if you're not enjoying the experimentation with the art form, then you'll never find the best discoveries. It is a playful thing, regardless of what subject matter you're doing. And the more you play with craft and technique, the more of a safety net you'll have for what's really important in puppetry, which is your point of view. And so that's what I want. That's what I want younger puppeteers to know, is that when you put your point of view onto your work, it is actually the universal discussion you have with an audience. That in the specific experience and stories you tell, it unleashes a universal connection with an audience. And I don't know, in a lot of the training that's going on in puppetry, if that aspect is being taught of content, text, interpretation of content, and artistic point of view. That all sounds a bit lofty. It also comes after you've played and experimented a while. I don't expect a 23-year-old to have a point of view because they're 23. Some do because of where they live and where they grew up and the conditions of the world around them. A lot of young people have an immediate point of view because of circumstance that maybe some soft Westerners don't have. But regardless of when you get to having a point of view, put that into your work, because that's the only thing you have to attach to this craft, is your personal take on our species, on our humanity, on our world. Regardless of whether you're holding a paintbrush or dancing or playing a violin or jiggling a puppet around, when you attach a point of view, it becomes yours. And when it becomes yours, and I mean this so sincerely, it becomes ours, the audience, because we get to know you.